the deer are eating all my plants, so I had to spray this really bad smelling stuff on them to keep them away. And then I have the citronella going here to keep the mosquitoes away. So there's a lot of smells in the air right now, but it's not bad. It's not bad. We can keep going here, and it's very important to keep going because time is marching forward very quickly right now. We're, you know, getting close to July, and July is really the go month. It's the big month where a lot of dust-ups, a lot of blow-ups will occur in the world. Major tipping points are coming. So it's very important to lay out some preparation for this, and the type of advice that I'm giving may not seem very applicable to anything right now. It may seem a little abstract. But at some point, once the world is embroiled, as it will be, you will certainly, something will click to remember, and you'll say, aha. And you'll see, oh yeah, okay, now I see the importance of looking at it that way. Now, foremost, it's very important to keep in mind that complex, confusing situations do not necessarily have a complex, confusing resolution. Actually, they can have a very simple resolution. But we tend to assume that if something's really complex, it needs a complex answer. That's a big, big mistake, because it simply isn't true. Okay? That's like when you're in pitch darkness. You may think that you have to think your way through instead of just flicking on the light switch. You know, like you're moving about a room with all this furniture in it and tripping on stuff and bumping into things and knocking stuff off. And you think, wow, this is really a complex, very complex, confusing situation I'm in. I don't know how to move. I'm afraid to move, etc. And then you think, wait a minute, here's a wall. What's that? It's a light switch. Flick it on. Bingo. No more problems. Very simple solution. So as the world is embroiled in extreme complexity and your mind cannot wrap itself around the problems, cannot find a solution, all you have to do is remember, wait a minute, I'm pre-qualified to experience perfect peace, pre-qualified to experience perfect love, pre-qualified to experience an effect that is unchanging, that is totally steady, which means I'm pre-qualified to remember what I really am, my true identity. I don't need to be concerned about what happens to false identity, because it's not identity at all. It's just a crazy dance that we were paying attention to. And the crazy dance continues, but we're pre-qualified to turn away from the crazy dance and see a very perfectly stable, unmodified effect that just gently overlays everything. Pre-qualified. Just remember that. I'm pre-qualified. Now, secondly, the only talent anyone needs, ever needs in existence, the only talent is to recognize they don't need any talent to be qualified to experience perfect peace, perfect love, perfect stillness. They're pre-qualified. So the only talent we need is to recognize we don't need any talent. So however we are right now is perfectly apt, perfectly qualified, or perfectly qualified right now, and in whatever condition we find ourselves, whatever condition anyone finds themselves. So is there really a crazy dance going on at all? The fact is, it's completely meaningless. If anyone can see the complete meaninglessness of it, you know, then they are certainly going to choose to experience and abide in unconditional love. And then they'll be reassuring everyone else. And we're working towards that point. So these pointers, these keys, may seem, you know, well, sound pretty good, sound very reasonable. But you wonder, well, how can I apply that right now, etc.? Well, pretty soon you'll begin to realize, yeah, I need some keys. I need to realize I don't need any talent. I don't even need the talent of realization. I don't need any talent at all. I don't need any qualities at all. I don't need to have some. I don't need to lack some. doesn't matter what the dance I've been paying attention to about false identity, doesn't matter what that dance has been, it makes no difference whatsoever. Because everything that we've been paying attention to in existence is just a false dance, a meaningless dance. So why would we need to draw any conclusions or learn anything from it? All we need to know is we don't need to know anything about it. And whatever we know doesn't matter. It doesn't disqualify us. So it's a very simple solution to this vast complexity. It's like throwing on a light switch. What we know about what is meaningless itself is meaningless. It's unimportant, has no value, doesn't disqualify us. Nothing can disqualify us from being what we are, from remembering what we are. Cannot be disqualified. Of course, we chose the idea of trying to change what we are. So we believe that what we are can be changed. So we believe it can, what we are can be disqualified, can be changed, can be destroyed, all this stuff. None of that's true. We have no power to change what we are. We have no power to become something different than what we are. No matter how long, no matter what we try, how long we try it, no matter how upside down our belief and faith becomes, makes no difference. None. Zero. And we don't need any talent. We don't even need the talent of seeing that. Nothing is needed in order to be qualified, unconditional love. There's no conditions present to step into the experience of unconditional love, perfect peace, vision of oneness, the overlay that overlays everything that arises in existence equally present right now, as it always is present, perfect stillness, unchanging, unmoving. Nirvana means not moving. In the Eastern teachings, that's the goal. Nirvana is the goal. Samadhi, nirvana, the experience of this unmoving effect. And that perfectly reflects what we really are, our true identity. And thereby we are reassured of our true identity is still perfectly intact. That's the goal. And everyone is pre-qualified from the very beginning. They didn't become pre-qualified through some effort. We are essentially, inherently qualified to know what we are. What we are cannot be changed. So of course we're pre-qualified to remember what we are. How could we be otherwise? So when times get tough and you seem to be completely the dance that you're identifying with becomes very confusing, as it will become very shortly. The world will be embroiled in the pursuits of the flesh. And all angles of that, the pursuits of the flesh, are well known what that is. And you don't have to identify with that or pay attention to it, because you're pre-qualified to pay attention to perfect unconditional love, perfect stillness, perfect awareness, pure consciousness, pure space, the great emptiness. All these terms refer to the effect that doesn't change, that doesn't waver. It's not modifiable. It's steady. We call it, pure. It's steady. There's no admixture. It's not being mixed with anything. The term the Virgin Mary actually is not referring to a person, it's referring to this unconditional love, this unwavering effect, immaculate, it's immaculate and unchanging and perfectly pure. In other words, nothing can mix with it. And when they say that that Virgin Mary is a co-redemptrix, what is meant is this experience is the means, is the perfect reflection of our true identity. Christ refers to our true identity. And then this perfect mirror, this effect that doesn't change, that reflects and perfectly reminds us of what we really are. So we just personify these things into people, into persons, etc. It's not a person. What we are is not a person. We're not a person. Spirit is not a person. It's not a human being. A human form can be overlaid by the remembrance, by perfect love, yes. But the human form is just a meat suit, like a suit of clothes. It's not a, we're not a person, we're not a human being. We're spirit, we're free. We're immaterial. We're beyond time and space and energy and form and nature, beyond all of that. Not in that at all. So religion has personified these things, and as such has sort of taken a step back, sort of a step away to the side of it. It's become difficult to understand these things. But we don't have to use personifications. We don't really. It's much better to talk directly about the situation rather than allegories and symbols and all these type of little more indirect personified way of teaching, which actually can lead to a lot of troubles. Now, it's a certain state, like children, they love picture books, right? They love picture books. They love it. Later on, people become more interested in abstract concepts. But so in religion starts out with picture books, so to speak, and personifies everything for as people are starting out. And later on, you graduate more towards more and more abstract, conceptual, big picture concepts. Are not really attracted to the picture book stuff anymore. Don't have to continuously work through sort of mystical symbology that's pointing to something else. It's not needed anymore. Like I said, the fifth dimensional teaching, there's no need for any of that. I don't feel the slightest need to engage in that kind of stuff at all, because it's a step removed. It's not you know, direct at all. A couple steps removed. And words themselves are not direct, really. In fact, the highest teacher, the most effective teaching, if you're ready for it, is someone who just sits in silence. No need to ask any questions, no need for them to say anything, because it's understood that what they're doing is they're showing you how completely steady the overlay is, unconditional love, and how it's unconditional. There's asking no conditions of anyone, and everyone is already pre-qualified. They transmit that to you in silence. There's an experience, a direct, you can simply pay attention to them, and they will convey this fact to you. As soon as you start using words are subject to interpretation, very much so. And then you get a feeling that it's less unstable. But if they sit in stillness and silence, you get a much stronger experience of the steadiness of it. The assurance becomes very powerful. And our prayer should be that we have access to that type of assurance, that type of teacher. If I could, if we could find one like that, we should go. Don't need to say anything. Don't need to ask any questions whatsoever. Because either they're going to give you that assurance or not. And if they don't, they don't. What good are questions? What good are questions, really? Either the assurance is there or it's not. And if it's not, you need to find where it is. I often consider, what if I came across such a teacher? What would I ask them? And the answer is I wouldn't ask anything. They either got it or they don't. What good is asking a question going to do? Are they going to reassure me better through answering a question? No. They'll reassure me better through silence. There's silence. And their silence has to be, you know, legitimate. There are plenty of people that can be silent, not say anything, and look intense. But the stillness and silence of a true God-realized being is really unique. Because it's a blissful silence. It's a loving silence. It's a silence that is overflowing with blissful, carefree reassurance. Effortlessly. A tremendous thing. The quality of that silence is something that is amazing. And if you see that, you experience it, then you'll know. You'll say, I'm sure this really is true reassurance, true assurance here. This is totally legit. Be no doubt. And of course, then questions will push up again and say, well, maybe I should ask him something, you know. Well, don't need to. Because then the assurance will get a little less. Because they'll answer in some way. If they answer, and they say, what do they mean by that? Not sure what they meant by those words. And then, you know, you start thinking about it. And before it's too long, you've kind of pulled yourself back into some doubt again. That's normal. But, you know, if you can, the best way is, again, silence. That's why I've said in some other videos, you know, the best teacher is the one that you feel you don't need to ask any questions of. Meaning, you are certain that they are certain. And all you want to do is drink in that certainty, you know. It's like you have a glass of pure, wonderful, refreshing water, and you're very thirsty. And you start drinking it. And you don't set it down and start asking questions like, where'd you find this water? What's the name of it? What do you call this water? How much do you have of it? And blah, 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 on and on and on. No, you keep drinking it. You keep drinking it because you feel your thirst going away, and you keep drinking it. You know, worried about asking, you know, all these questions about it. What do you call it, you know? Forget about it. It's not important. And maybe we want to reassure the teacher that we're getting it. But they know we're getting it. They don't have to say anything. Very fact that you're there means that you want to experience that reassurance. And they know that they're giving it, so they know you're getting it. No need, no doubt in their mind whatsoever. And this may all sound like a fantasy, but it's not. Occasionally, that type of reassurance does animate a body here. I'm not saying they take a birth, I'm not saying they're in the body, any of that stuff. Sure, a body is born and moves around, etc. But that which is reassuring, pouring out reassurance in the world, is not in a body. It's not identifying with the body. Doesn't believe that that is a body, and was really never born at all. So certainly, there's nothing to prevent that from happening. Maybe even we'll be fortunate enough at this time for such a situation. I don't know. It's something that we can certainly put our aspirations toward, because that will really, really, really help everyone. It'll have a tremendous trickle-down effect. Because anytime, what we're trying to do is we're trying to catch wind of genuine reassurance that we are pre-qualified, 100% guaranteed. If we really could feel that, what a difference that would make. It would change everything. What we want to do is what we do now is we say, yeah, but what if we weren't? Which is a hypothetical. And we're addicted to the hypothetical is the problem. When we ask, why do we have such trouble being reassured? Because we're addicted to the hypothetical. If I say that what we are. Reality cannot be disarmed in any way. We will say, yeah, but what if that wasn't true? Or, you know, if we say our spirit identity cannot be changed, it's immaculate, and that's what we are. And we say, yeah, but what if we weren't that? What if we could be harmed? What if we could be changed? What if? Yeah, but what if? That's the hypothetical. And the hypothetical is meaningless, isn't it? I mean, where does it take us? Where does it get us to? Nowhere. It's like saying, what if truth wasn't true? And we're just playing out the what-if game. But, yeah, but what-if game. The we game, what if? We're playing the we game. Yeah, but what if, what if, what if, what if? What if truth wasn't true? What if reality wasn't real? What if we were really lost? What if we didn't have a true identity? What if God wasn't the prime creator? What if we were the prime creators? What if this is our home? What if, you know, what if, what if? Again, none of it's true. So when we touch upon truth, we'll realize that part of our familiarity will say, yeah, but what if this weren't true? And, you know, what do you say to that? Well, that's what we struggle with. And that's what we need reassurance for. And literally everyone in this world is playing the yeah, but what if game. All of existence is playing the yeah, but what if game. I say it's a hypothetical scenario. That's what it is. It's a hypothetical scenario. Nothing more than that. What can you do about it? You can't. If someone wants to play that game, what can you do? Nothing. You can't, you know, prevail upon them not to play it. It's a game. A what-if game. There's nothing you can point out to someone who's playing a what-if game. There's nothing you can point out to them that can stop it. Because whatever you point out, they'd say, yeah, but what if you didn't point it out to me? You see what I'm saying here? You can have an experience of reality and know the truth and hypothetical and say, yeah, but what if that wasn't true? They'd say, what if you didn't have the experience? In other words, I've had the experience of reality and knowing that it's can never be harmed in any way. It's invulnerable. But the ego can say, yeah, but what if you didn't have that experience? Where would you be then? See how that works? And a great perfect teacher can come in the world and reassure us, and the ego will say, yeah, but what if they hadn't come into the world? What would it be like then? And they try to engage you in reacting to what ifs. What if, you know, you hadn't gotten help? How would you feel then? You see how that works? Very tricky. Let's say we get help. Let's say we're perfectly reassured. And let's say we have perfect calm, peace of mind. The ego will say, yeah, but what if none of that had ever happened? What if you hadn't got reassured? What if you didn't have peace of mind? What if, how would you feel then? And so, you know, it boils down to this situation of what you want to experience. You can experience the what if scenario. How would you feel if you didn't feel perfectly stable? Well, you'd feel unstable. But all that's hypothetical. So we're all simply engaging in the what-if game of hypothetical feelings, hypothetical situations. It's like, what if we weren't invulnerable? Well, then we could be bodies, and all these bodies would be tearing each other to pieces, and we'd be going through all this misery, etc., etc. But that's all hypothetical. Question is it really happening? We think we're experiencing it, because hypothetically, we're imagining what if what if this was the case? So we have the creative power to, if we say, okay, I want to know what would it be like if this is the case, and then we believe we're experiencing it. Faith, we have faith in it. We believe we're experiencing it, but our true identity is not experiencing it. So we aren't. We really aren't experiencing it. But we believe that we're experiencing it. We think we're experiencing it. Like in a dream, we're taking a rest and we fall asleep, and in the dream we say, well, what if I wasn't just lying here on the bed, but I was, off being chased somewhere throughout a city, and all these things are happening. What if all those are happening? So your dream goes through all these what ifs, and during the time you're dreaming, you believe it's real. You believe it's actually, you're actually experiencing it's actually happening to you, and then when you wake up, you realize, oh, that was just a what if. I was just kind of dreaming about what if this stuff were actually taking place. What would be the story then? How would that be? And it's there isn't any cure, so to speak, forced cure on us. Because whatever cure comes up, we could always say, yeah, but what if that cure hadn't taken place? How would we feel then? So, I think we need to see this. Just how it is. And why you cannot convince anybody else. Because they can just say, yeah, but what if you weren't so convincing? See? No matter what you do, they could say, yeah, but what if you hadn't have done that? How would I feel then? So it's kind of frustrating, isn't it, in this world? You try to help others, they can always say, yeah, but what if you hadn't have helped me? And somebody, like someone does an intervention on an addiction, and someone will say, yeah, you did intervention, et cetera, but what if you hadn't have done it? How would I, what would my life be like then? And then they go right back into it, you see? It's amazing, this capacity we exercise for the hypothetical. But how do we deal with this? What we do is we realize, where's this coming from? It's coming from our desire to be prime creator. So it's like saying, yeah, but what if we weren't what we really are? Then we could be something else. It's the desire to be something else other than what we are that gives rise to this hypothetical, but this capriciousness, which is, on the level of capriciousness, it's uncurable. Because again, no matter what cure is employed, we can always say, yeah, but what if that cure hadn't been employed, then how would I feel? And then we're right back in, the suffering and the misery. It's literally that quick. So what we have to do is we have to go deeper than that, deeper level. And say, why are we doing this? And if we see that it's an attempt because we want to be prime creator, and we realize that we can never accomplish this, then we realize that this capricious hypothetical game, or what if game we're playing, it just is what it is. It's not going to ever get us anything we really want. And to realize that we're playing this game because we think it's going to get us something that we want, really want, and it's not. That kind of knocks the stuffing out of, takes the wind out of the sails of the situation. Because without taking that wind out of the sails, we'll just keep doing it, because it seems to give us a power, right? That's the only power the world really has, and it's no power at all, because it doesn't get us anything. How can we say that something is a power if it doesn't get us anything? Well, it buys time. But does buying time get us anything? No. So it'll buy a lot of stuff, but all that stuff it buys still doesn't get us anything. So it doesn't get us anything at all. Doesn't change what we are. And that's its purpose. And again, it'll say, yeah, but what if I could change it? Well, yeah, but it never will. So what's the point of it? What's the purpose of it? See, what we have to do is we have to keep taking the wind out of the sails of this capriciousness, the what-if hypothetical game that we're playing. You cannot approach it directly. So my teaching seems to be indirect. And when you're in the turmoil that's to come here, you'll remember this indirect teaching style. And then something you might say, I know this is all capricious hypotheticalness that I'm facing, and there's nothing I can do to stop it at the level that it's arising, but I can take the wind out of the sails in my own own perspective of it. That I can see it as meaningless, because it'll never get anywhere. It won't arrive. It has no power, because it never provides anything. It doesn't change what I am at all. So there's no power in it. There's no meaning in it. And that enables you to take a step back from it. The real perfect teachers here are not the slightest bit interested in what's taking place in the world. Not because they're above it or it's not important. None of those reasons is true when people say, why aren't they paying attention to it, you know? Because they realize it's completely meaningless. The good, the bad, the ugly, all completely meaningless. Doesn't accomplish anything. It's all a hypothetical based on wanting to be something different than what we really are. So they look at it from that perspective. And that's not a perspective that we were used to looking at all. And people ascribe all sorts of motivations to perfect teachers. That's really not so. It's really not true. The reason, the way that they are, the way they are, we have to be very clear about that. And that takes the wind out of our sails of thinking that something meaningful is taking place, or potentially meaningful in all this. No, nothing. The what-if game never gives us anything. It purchases a lot of stuff, but never gives us anything. You know, it's like it keeps setting up more and more factories, more and more raw materials, producing more and more stuff, but it never gives us anything. Just buying time, just keeps on churning it out. You know, what if, what about this? What if this was the case? What if, it just keeps churning out what ifs? What if you were a body? What if you were in a world? What if you had to go through a life? What if those are all what ifs? We're not in a body, we're not in a world, we're not going through a life, not doing any of that. It's just a what if. What if we had all those situations? What if we were sick? What if our mind was sick? Our mind's not sick. What if we needed healing? We don't need healing. So what if? What if we were sick? What if we needed to be healed? What would we do then? Etc., etc. All what ifs. None of them true. And a teacher in perfect silence and reassurance just reassures us of this, because you realize that they're really not interested in the dance, the what if dance. They look right through it, like they're not even seeing it. And they're not. As far as meaning goes, it's recognized at the level stripped of all meaning, like a shadow, but it doesn't rise to the level of any meaning whatsoever. Trying to interpretation is not necessary. No interpretation needed. Perfect teachers are not interpreting anything. It's direct seeing. See right through it. Not even through it. There's no meaning to see through. It's meaningless. And so, you know, we can get there. We just have to keep taking the wind out of our sails. It's like tacking a sailboat. Instead of trying to catch the wind, we're trying to tack in such a manner as we get free of the wind. Become calmer and calmer and calmer. As we do that, we find maybe ourselves tacking into a calm, very calm place where the atmosphere is very still. Speaking of that, the atmosphere tonight is also perfectly still here. As still as last night again. Really nothing. Not even a leaf is trembling or moving. I have some chimes, number of chimes, and they're very, very sensitive to the slightest breeze, and they are slightly trembling, just a little bit. Another fabulous evening in California. We're very spoiled here. Very spoiled. But I always say that this type of atmosphere brings about a remembrance for us of reality. So part of the pressure of living in a beautiful place is it does bring up memories of reality, and we feel homesick. So people might think, oh, you're so fortunate, you're living in one of the best places in California and all of that, but I tell you, it's enormous pressure to remember to choose unconditional love, to remember reality, because the homesickness is just incredible. You get so frustrated because you're being reminded, you're remembering something and you can't quite remember what it is. And so you feel, you know, tremendous push. Feeling, I gotta remember something. It evokes that. When you're in a really beautiful place, you may think, oh, let's just luxuriate in it, etc. It doesn't work that way. Doesn't never work that way. Because what you feel is, oh boy, this is reminding me of something. I've got to remember what it is that it's reminding me of. And so you become, you know, frantic. It's not the sybaritic, you know, lifestyle that people imagine. Maybe they're up there in somewhere snowbound and they're terrible weather. They think, oh, you know, California. People come out here and they have, you know, one of those great picture postcard days. And they think, oh, I've got to move here. It's so unbelievably nice, etc. But if you're born here and you live here, you find it's not like that at all. You feel driven by something relentless that just won't let you alone. It's horrible. You know, what is it that I'm forgetting? What is it I'm forgetting? I know I'm forgetting something because this is reminding me of it. Like an evening like this, it's just stupendous. But it's pushing something, you know, the frustration. No, it's a reminder. What am I forgetting? You know, always here. So it's really a torturous place to live. You know, if you live like in a really nasty place, in a terrible place, you know what? It's very easy to always fantasize that if you just move to some other place, everything would be fine, right? And cold, foggy, crime, noisy, horrible, and you say, ah, you know what? All my problems are because I live here. But if I just move to California, everything would be fine. But when you live in California, you realize there's no place else to go that's any better. I've talked to people who've traveled the world, quite a few, seem to have gone almost everywhere in the world. They come back here and they say, this is the best place in the world, guaranteed. You'll never find a better place than this. That puts pressure on you, doesn't it? Because you realize, hey, I'm in the best place in this world, and it's still terrible. I mean, I'm not happy at all. That is it's an absolute shocker. Most people, you know, can't handle that. They'll take a vacation here for a little while, but then they'll go back to to their place. But if you're here constantly, you start to realize, whoa, you know, this is the best place in the world, and I still feel terrible. It's not it at all. So, you know, what do I do? And you start thinking, it becomes almost like panicky. It's a really heavy, heavy burden. It's like tonight, it's so perfect, it's so peaceful. I'm thinking, you know, I've got to maximize this opportunity. Because it just doesn't get any better than this here in this world. It just doesn't. And rather than just luxuriate in it, it doesn't happen like that. If you're from out of town, come here, you may luxuriate on a weekend somewhere here and say, wow, it's just so fabulous. And then you go back. But if you're all the time, you cannot just spend all your time luxuriating in it, how nice it is. Something eats at you, really starts eating at you. Terrible. You know, oh, really, living in California has been terrible. but useful. Useful. Because without that thorn in the side, that frustration, we would keep fantasizing, oh, you know, I just have, if I could have another life somewhere else, you know, I'll be okay. You know, the people that are just going through hell in this world, they can always say, well, you know, I know there's a better place in this world, and if I die, I'll be reborn. I'm going to go to reborn in one of those other places that's nicer. But what happens when you're in the nicest place? What do you do then? You can't say, well, I can just be reborn somewhere else in this world. No, because you're completely spoiled already. It's intolerable. I cannot go somewhere that's worse. People always want to go somewhere that's better. And you say, well, there is no place better. So what do? You know, it's like horrible. Puts the pressure on. You know, I don't want to return to this world because I can't do any better where I am right now. And where I am right now, I'm still completely, you know, unfulfilled, unhappy. The ego still is right there, playing the what-if game. So, I got no hand to play at all, no cards to play. That's a scary thing. That's why people in California have turned to drugs, a lot of them. Historically, because you're here, everything's perfect, you know, you can't realize there's no place better in the world, and you still feel this unhappy, and you still feel something gnawing at you, and you know what, in order to deal with that, they get in, you know, Californians have gotten into all sorts of stuff, mysticism, drugs, you name it, you know, all sorts of therapies, etc., because it drives them crazy, you know. I've you know, realized I've been through a lot of stuff. And realize, you know, where is it coming from? You have to see it. What's really happening? It's just this shock. My gosh, I have it all, and it's not enough. And I can't ever really get a better situation here. I mean, I go to places that are just, people have the most incredible mansions, most incredible landscaping, most incredible wealth and privilege, and they can travel wherever they want to travel. And the cars and everything, they have it all. Plus they have, you know, they have a wonderful view in the, you know, the best place, you know, climate wise in the world, and access to the everything, the culture in the Bay Area, everything. And you know, I've been to plenty of those places. So can't get anything better than that. And so what do they do? What's next? Scary thing. That's why sometimes California has a reputation for people getting a little nutty. You know, you have to understand where that's coming from. Because they say, oh boy, I mean, where do I go from here? Of course, and the real answer is, you remember your true identity. Which is why there's a lot of spiritual teaching coming out of California, always has been. My grandparents came from St. Louis, Missouri. Or was it East St. Louis, Illinois? They were in that St. Louis area. And they were in banking, and they lost everything in the Great Depression. Had to sell everything to pay off the depositors. So they literally only had a car and some furniture and drove out west with nothing. No savings, nothing. And they ended up camping out on a beach at Laguna Beach, California. Back in the early 1930s, probably. And at that time, I mean, it was like paradise. Laguna Beach was unbelievable. They just lived on the beach. Just massive vegetation of flowers and beauty. They're like a, you know, island, like a paradise. It was just unbelievably nice. And then Los Angeles at that time, with all the citrus groves, it was just, you know, amazing place. So, you know, they thought they had arrived in paradise at that time. you know, but it didn't turn out that way. You know, you have to make a living, and the war, World War II came, and, you know, that was just the opposite of paradise. But then again, where do you go from, you know, living on the beach at, you know, in Laguna Beach? So, turn to mysticism. So, like, my family history was people who were exploring spiritual truths, higher truths, trying to find something better. What's the next step? Because they experienced living on Laguna Beach. They experienced spending time driving through all the citrus groves, going to the beach there, living like unbelievably nice life. And it wasn't enough. And they realized they can never go back to East St. Louis because they've seen something much, much better. But this wasn't enough. So what do? You start searching for something better. And you know you can't find it in this world. And so, you know, there's a reason for people searching within, looking for something better. Here in California, here in various beautiful places around the world. There are other beautiful places, but I don't think you really can beat certain places of California. Are just pretty amazing. And, you know, like I say, there's a lot of tormented souls out here. Most people are in therapy, taking antidepressants, working like crazy, you know, just because they're suffering. You know, what do I do now? This isn't it. This isn't enough. I'm not happy. Something's still wrong. I'm still confused. I'm still fearful. I still feel vulnerable. And yet the surroundings, you know, I know I can't get any better. So, like, you know, what do I do? It's crazy. Scary. You know, I live in an ideal neighborhood. I have ideal neighbors. So peaceful, so calm. You know, nothing you can say that's bad at all. And yet the entire complex of the ego, you know, is still dancing. It's insanity. And the whole world. Here's another key I want to share. Really, if we truly are human bodies, the truth we know is that what we are is one. There's no separation. Reality, there's no separation in reality. So if we claim that our reality is human bodies, the fact is then that whatever happens to anybody anywhere, it's also happening to us. So anyone is dying right now, we're also dying. Anyone is sick, we're also sick. Anyone who's afraid, we're also afraid. Anyone who's being tortured, we're also being tortured. Anyone who's fearful, we're also fearful. Anyone who's experiencing anything, we're also experiencing that. If it were true. But again, it's a what if. What if we were human bodies? What if we were separate? What if, okay, we're not human bodies? So, that is the key to the situation. Because there's no way that if we believe we're a human body, there's no way we can be happy. It's impossible. Because we would literally then be experiencing all the misery and death and sickness in the world too. And whatever happiness we're experiencing, we simultaneously, the totality of the experiencing would just be this massive mad dance of existence. Right now there's, you know, millions of people starving to death in the world. Millions of people dying of sicknesses. Malaria, you name it. Millions of people engaged in conflict. Millions of people engaged in, the entire planet is engaged in insecurities. Millions of people have terrible mental illnesses. Millions of people are in hospitals. Hundreds of millions maybe are in hospitals having surgery every day. I'm sure millions of people are having surgery. People are coming blind every day. You know, every type of illness unimaginable people are having throughout this planet. Somebody's having that today. You know, some mothers all over the planet dying in childbirth every day. All of that would be happening to us if any of it were true. So you can't have it both ways. You can't say I'm a human being and I'm happy because nothing bad is happening to me. That's like making an illusion and then overlooking the illusion, which is insanity. It's like saying, what if I were insane, then I'd be happy. It's like saying, what if I was a human body, but also what if I was insane and being a human body didn't cause me any problems? Or what if playing the game of what if didn't cause me any problems? What if then? You see how we double down on it. Again, we play the game of what if playing the game of what if didn't cause any problems for me. We say, what if I was a human, and then what if being a human, I wouldn't have to experience what all the humans are experiencing? What if then? So we double down on the what if game. And we can triple down on it, and just actually, literally, there's no end to how much we can keep doubling down. Just keep what-ifing. So you can see how we can get entangled in delusion. And if we ask the question, how in the world did I get so entangled in delusion? As we all have been. No exception here. With the fact was, I was aware I was getting entangled into it. But the fact is, and all the doubling down can happen very fast. And who knows how far you're removed from the original what if. And you think you have to work your way back, and you've got you completely lost. You don't know even how to work your way back to the original what if. But the original what if is, what if I could change what I am? And you just say, well, I cannot. So that what if game doesn't go anywhere. So we have all doubled down, you know, immensely, maybe millions of times. And I said, you know, originally in this video, start off with, I said, a super complex problem doesn't need to have a complex answer, a solution. So we have doubled down to such an extent, we have this vastly complex delusional system. We feel completely trapped in it, and we can't find our way home. But the fact is, all we have to do is just say that the what-if game, however it's played, has no effect on what we really are at all. It doesn't matter if we double down infinitely. It has no effect on what we are whatsoever. And therefore, all we have to do is remember what we are. And we don't require any what-if game for that at all. The unconditional love is there. So you see, in one step, we've extricated ourselves from infinite entanglements. And we thought all along, oh, I have to extricate myself step by step by step by step. Each entanglement I've got to untangle. And now we're seeing, I don't even have to untangle any of it. It's all meaningless. Why spend time untangling something that's meaningless? And because I have something that will remind me of what I am. And that's all I need to do. And this is a, you know, what they call a paradigm shift of epic proportions. It's the only paradigm shift that's really needed. Again, infinite entanglement and doubling down. What if the what if, and that the what if, that the what if, that the what if none of that had any effect on me? What if this also had no effect on me? What if this, what if had no effect on me? On and on and on and on and on, and all sorts of different, you know, we create this vast, vast entanglement. And we just say, well, none of that has any meaning. What I am is still completely unchanged, and all I need to do is remember that. So none of that matters. All I need to do is choose to experience unconditional love, which reminds me what I am. The amount of entanglement is meaningless to unconditional love. It simply is not changing. It simply does its thing, which is remind us of what we are. It's not reacting to any entanglements. It's not trying to untangle us from anything. Because it within unconditional love, there's no entanglements. None. There's no what-ifs at all. So, and again, by being reminded of what we are, we will see that what-ifs have no effect on us, what we are. Therefore, they're all meaningless, equally meaningless. And so where before you thought you had a depth of field of infinite entanglements, now you see it's completely flat, has zero meaning. So where, in something that is absolutely flat with no meaning, where is the entanglement? There is none. So this is pretty, this is very cool teaching. I like it. You know, this is what I came here to do. Give out this type of teaching and keep it going. See how we can get even more reassurance. But this is crucial. Simple solution to a seemingly impossible complexity. Because literally, we have doubled down so much that we feel as if we're impossibly lost. Never going to find our way back. Or if we do, it's going to take unbelievable long time and difficulty, so why even try? It's overwhelming. But now suddenly we see that it's as simple as throwing on a switch in a room. Simply choose to experience unconditional love, perfect peace. That reminds us of what we are. And we realize, ah, what I am is cannot be changed, cannot be modified at all by any what-if. Doesn't matter how many times you double down on it. It all has zero effect. Therefore, all the vast array of entanglements are equally meaningless, flat. I don't have to do anything. I don't have to untangle anything. Because I see meaningless. Dust. Less than dust. Nothing. As it relates to what I am, it's nothing. So what is there to disentangle in nothingness? There is nothing to disentangle. So we don't disentangle. We don't have to disentangle anything. We nearly need to recognize that we don't need to disentangle anything. And we're right here doing that. That's the satsang. That's the purpose of satsang. Clarification. Satsang really means clarification. Sitting with truth, hearing the truth, which means clarification. Because truth is beyond words. So when we're hearing anything, we're hearing clarification. Now there's some satsang that is just silent sitting, which is feeling the presence of reassurance. And so often satsang is a blend of that silent sitting and then some clarification. That's how it goes. Don't need anything more than that. That's it. When we get there, we've arrived at what we need. The reassurance and the clarification go hand in hand. Recognize there's a completely simple solution to what seemed to be an impossibly complex problem. And all the time we felt we needed, we felt we need infinite amount of time to disentangle ourselves from all this. But, you know, the problem is, in that perspective, fact is that we're continuously doubling down. As we live in this world, we're always doubling down on what-ifs, constantly, adding tons every day. And so, you know, we may try to disentangle and do all this introspection and therapy, etc., thinking that we're trying to diminish this vast pile, you know, this mountain of what-ifs. And we look up, you know, after all the slaving away for so many times, we slave away for 20 years, we look up, the mountain's way bigger than it was before. And, you know, then we say, oh my gosh, I got to work harder. We work another 20 years to look up. The mountain, again, is way vaster now than before. We've added way more what-ifs. So you can see how one might despair at that point. Say, there's no way, you know. It's like it would take one step forward and two steps back in the world. It's like trying to generate quote unquote good karma, and you know, for every good karma we generate two that are bad, and so we think we're getting somewhere, and then things are getting worse. If we look at it from that perspective, you can see why people just turn to drink and drugs, turn to wine, women, and song, and just say, "Wow, I just got to try and drown out this what I'm seeing, because what I'm seeing is it just things just get worse." But now in satsang, we have a different perspective, and we say that mountain is meaningless. It's flat. Has no effect on reality. Therefore, there is no entanglement. My identity is not entangled in anything. It's not entangled in what-ifs. It's free of entanglement. It's free and unencumbered. Totally free. There's no entanglements in reality. So all I need to do is remember reality. And for that, all I need is experience unconditional love. This effect that doesn't change. There's no entanglements. There's an effect wherein there is zero entanglements. And no possibility of any. That's all I need to do. That's it. Totally simple. Total simple solution. And this goes back to the tale that Ramana Maharshi told about someone walked a long ways, made a pilgrimage to his place in Tiruvannamalai, and said, "I look at my feet; they're just torn up by so many thorns and stones. It's horrible. Why can't you help me with that?" And Ramana said, "Just wear a pair of shoes. Wear a pair of sandals. Simple, easy. Boom. One thing. Right. Put on a pair of sandals. No more troubles with the stones and thorns." Doesn't matter if there's a trillion thorns, right? You got a good pair of sandals, not one of them is going to get you. Won't bother you at all. That's what he's saying. Is no matter how many entanglements, what ifs there are that we're entangled in, which for all of us is just continually compounding, like mosquitoes. None of those affect what we are at all. We're not entangled in any of them. And therefore, they're all equally meaningless. Because their whole purpose is based on what if we could change what we are. And since we cannot change what we are, they're meaningless. So you can get the sense our situation is not as bad as we think it is. There's genuine hope. And we can see this conceptually, and eventually it deepens for us. That's what we are aiming for. But at least getting it on a conceptual level is certainly helpful. It's not the answer, because again, I said the answer is to experience unconditional love. Until we actually experience it, we will keep believing that the compounding, all this compounding of what-ifs, will be frightful for us. And we'll keep thinking we need to undo some of them. But what we're really doing is pointing back to we need to experience. We need to be reminded. We need to experience the perfect reminder of what we really are. Which is this. Which is there for us. It's constantly present. Every moment is present for us. Perfect stillness. Unchanging. It's not leaping from moment to moment. It's present. Every moment exactly in this moment as the previous moment as all previous moments, and in this moment as all subsequent moments, it's exactly the same, unchanging. So that's here right now, and exactly the same quality as will always be here. Of course, we'll say, "Well, what if it wasn't here?" And again, that there's no what ifs in unconditional love. There is no what ifs, so it's not entertaining any what ifs. So we can entertain the what ifs. In fact, we do. But unconditional love does not entertain what ifs. And that's the quality we're looking for. A perfect teacher does not entertain what ifs. They know. They're here. They know unconditional love is present. They know it. So they're not entertaining what ifs. And that's the rarest of the rare thing here in this world, because all the rest of us, we will entertain what ifs. That's why when we have a peak experience, it doesn't last, because we start entertaining what ifs. We entertain, well, what if I wasn't having this experience? You know, then what? And poof, it's gone. It's like magic. And we all think that we're wizards, you know, that we're magical, because we can make anything disappear. And we're entranced by that capacity. No matter what experience we have, we can make it disappear. And we love doing that. And people will take all sorts of medications and drugs, etc., to keep changing effects, making them disappear, make this disappear. We don't need to engage in that, though. So unconditional love does not engage in that at all, because it comes from a different idea. It comes from the idea of not trying to change what we are, not trying to be prime creator. So it's effortlessly not engaging in any what-ifs. Never. It never does. Never will. So we who are entertaining what-ifs, we have the opportunity to experience that which is not entertaining what-ifs. That's the great opportunity we always will have. It's just a matter of when we accept that opportunity. Say, oh, okay, wow. We don't have to stop ourselves from entertaining what-ifs, because we cannot. As long as we have not remembered what we are, we will still be prone to entertaining what-ifs. It's only when we have perfect reassurance of what we are that when we'll drop what ifs, because we'll drop the idea of trying to change what we are, because we'll see we cannot do it and we don't want to do it. And then we'll no longer entertain what ifs at all. But up until that point, we will entertain what ifs. That's why we need to experience that which does not entertain what ifs. That's our ally. We have an ally, an ever-present ally, that there's no way we can ever be without it, no matter where we are, what we're doing, who we are, who we think we are, no matter what if we're entertaining. That unconditional love is present, immediately present, in the exact unchanging quality that always has. And we can turn to that at any moment, at every moment, and simply experience, this is the experience of not entertaining any what-ifs. And that's what we all have to look forward to. No matter what ifs, no matter what the what ifs the world's entertaining. What if there's a, you know, terrible World War III? What if there's a terrible collapse of the stock market? What if there's a terrible hit on Earth by a coronal mass ejection from the sun? High energy particle cloud. What if there's a, you know, meltdown, global meltdown of civilization? What if this planet gets, you know, just remodel? What if all these things, what if these things are happening? These are all what ifs too. You say, well, I can turn to that which is not entertaining any what ifs. Remember, all of existence is a what if. This is a what if. What if I wasn't what I am? What if truth wasn't true? What if reality wasn't real? Then what? And we've conjured up all this stuff. What if reality wasn't stable? Well, then we'd have this terrible stock market would collapse. What if you know, reality wasn't stable? And what if reality wasn't invulnerable? Well, we'd have the sun, you know, hitting this planet with high energy cloud. So even these things are happening as what ifs. So as long as you entertain what ifs, if you entertain what ifs, you will then be experiencing these happenings, these what if happenings, as if, you know, they were happening. I mean, as if they somehow affect what we are. As if we need to find meaning in them. And we don't. Just what ifs. And then, of course, what ifs double down and say, yeah, this is a what if, but what if all of this kept going, and a lot of what if there's millions of what ifs, what if then that all added up to something that wasn't a what if? You know, that's the game that strings us along, and of course it never will. What ifs don't add up to anything other than other what ifs. And again, it's like multiplying zero. It's like saying, well, if we multiply zero long enough, it will become something other than zero. Not true. That's a falsity. Okay, that's a lie. Same thing. If you add up all these what ifs, somehow it will transform into not being a what if anymore. Become real. That's the transformation the ego keeps telling us about. Never will never happen. We don't need any transformation. We already are what we are. Invulnerable, perfect spirit. We're already that. Why do we need a transformation for? What needs to be transformed? Only the what ifs pray for transformation. That's, you know, their mantra. That's their marketing device. Yeah, what if? What ifs? We're no longer what ifs. That's basic. That's the mantra of what if. What if? What ifs? We're no longer what ifs. Aha! You see, and we think, uh-oh, that's got us. Wait, now we're in trouble. Now that's how we feel. We start getting nervous then. Oh, wait a minute. Wow, what if, what ifs, what if, what ifs were no longer what ifs? But that itself is a what if, isn't it? That's why I say it's flat. Like saying, what if billions of what ifs were not what ifs? That's still just one flat what if, right? I haven't gone anywhere. It's all flat. It's all meaningless. You're not really entangled at all. No one's really entangled at all. But if they just forget that what if, all what ifs were not what if, is just a single what if, and they think it's multiple what ifs, then lost, immediately lost in chaos, really. So we can see here how easy it is to pull out of chaos and how easy it is to jump back into it. If we lose sight, again, if someone says, well, what if all what ifs were not what ifs? Are we really lost in infinite what ifs and working our way through to that? I would say, what if infinite amount of what ifs led to not being a what if? Are we really lost on this circuitous path at all? Or is this statement just one single what if? It's just one what if. It's not many. What if we multiplied zero times infinite numbers? That's still just one statement. It's not infinite statements. So we're not lost in complexity. We're not lost in some vast numerical nightmare at all. Unless we are decide that we don't want to see this fact. But even when we don't want to see it, we're still not really lost. Because we're actually can right now recognize it. It's just one what if, really. And all what ifs are equally meaningless in the first place. So everything just simplifies immediately. Again, if we say, what if there was some what if that wasn't a what if? Okay, again, we could be immediately lost in searching for that what if, right? But actually, it's just one statement, one what if statement. That is, what if? That's the origin. What if there was some what if that wasn't a what if? That is contained, all the what ifs are contained in that one statement of what if this were so. But we can immediately say, well, it's not so. So we're not lost in any fast search. No need for any search whatsoever. So these are the tricks the ego plays. And we've played these games and tricks, and we think we're lost. And now we're seeing that actually we can snap out of that, like, right now. immediately. Recognizing one what if, how long does that take? Searching among billions of what ifs for the one that isn't a what if, how long is that going to take? Obviously, that's going to be a frantic nightmare. But realizing that the statement, what if this were so, is itself a what if, and it's only one what if. We see that right now. No, we don't need any time to see it at all. Just a moment. We say, oh, it's just a what, the whole thing is just one, a what if. What ifs are always just a what if. It's flat. Really, there's no dimension to it whatsoever. Then we can say, okay, I see it, and no need to see anything more than that. That's why someone will say, you know, Punjaji will say, call off the search. That's what he's saying, call off the search right now. Don't need to search anymore. You can see it right now. The what if? What if there was a what if out there that wasn't a what if? Well, that's just one what if. It's not all the what ifs. Don't need to. You can see it right there, right now. And you can see how this teaching really doesn't need to use personification at all. It's not necessary. This type of teaching is very, very direct and right, points out right what the situation really is. Why do we need to drag all sorts of mystical symbols into it, and personas and statues and all these rituals and all this stuff? What is that? Why do we need to drag any of that in there? Obviously, we don't. It's crisp and clean. And crisp and clean with no caffeine. It's like 7-Up teaching. Don't need to throw any caffeine into it whatsoever. Don't need to throw any food coloring and all this junk that's in the colas. You know, keep it crisp and clean with no caffeine. And so the night continues here. An airplane flying overhead. In this most bucolic and lovely settings, completely forgot about the settings. You see, as we get into satsang and the importance of that, and how it's all completely flat, and how we're not really trapped at all, the surroundings were completely forgotten. Perspective now towards our entrapment has changed, because we're certain, we know that we're going to throw up a what if on this. Like, what if this clarification hadn't happened? Then what? And we'll forget it that way. But maybe now we'll start to say, wait a minute. I'm just throwing a what if on it, up on it all. I haven't really, we have access to that now. Because we've all experienced clarity, and then poof, it's gone magically, because we want to continue to play the role of magicians. Yeah, it just made that clarity and certainty disappear. Wow, we're very powerful. We can make anything disappear. We can even make ourselves disappear. We can make our identity disappear. We can make reality disappear. We can make the prime creator disappear, because we're great magicians. Like, what if God, what if the prime creator was not prime creator? Poof. But now we say, well, wait a minute. That clarity only disappeared because I played the what-if game. And I remember that the what-if game makes itself seem very powerful by making statements about a lot of what-ifs. Like, what if some what-if somewhere in the cosmos was not a what-if? And then it completely intimidates me that way. Overawes me, just overwhelms me. But I said, wait a minute, wait. That's just one statement. Right here, right now. Like, what if there was a vast cosmos of what-ifs, but somewhere in there, one of the what-ifs was not a what-if. It was real. What would we do then? Well, what would we do then means we would be searching for that. But that's the whole scenario is a what-if. As soon as we take that what-if, forget the original what-if, then suddenly we're in a search for that some what-if that is not a what-if. And immediately we have gone from centered in truth and clarity to completely forgetting truth and clarity and feeling lost in a vast masquerade, in a vast search, just like that. And conversely, by remembering that the original what-if, the what-if that set this up is simply just one what-if talking about setting up a what-if. And we don't need to follow that. We don't need to forget the what-if, that it's only one what-if. So we're not lost in any masquerade at all. We're not lost in vast complexity. We're not engaged in any search. We're just present right now saying, well, wait a minute, that's a what-if. And what-ifs, I know what-ifs don't change what I am, so they're meaningless. And the ego, this takes the wind out of the ego sails. And the ego will say, yeah, what if it didn't take the wind out of my sails? And but you can quickly say, not get caught in the trap of overlooking that every what-if statement is just one what-if. It's like saying, what if we were lost in a million what-ifs? That's one statement. It's not a million what-ifs. And when we lose the capacity to see this, that's when we begin feeling unstable and panicky and terrified. And most all of us have been through that. And we're trying to come out of that. We're coming out of that now. We're leaving that behind. Because it's just a masquerade. It's just insanity. It's just a willing overlooking of the perfect flatness. There's no dimension to what-ifs. You can't say what-ifs were real. There's no dimension to that. Because if we look, we'll say, well, what-ifs are not real, so there's no need to search for what is meaningless. What is meaningless has no dimension to it, no depth, no richness to it. So if we say, what if out of billions of what-ifs there was what-if that wasn't a what-if, we don't need to go searching for that. Because we realize it's set in the context of a what-if. What if there was one that was not what-if? That is a what-if statement. There isn't any need to then think that we need to search for something that is not a what-if. So we keep, we're circling around this tree here. We've got the ego treed right now. We're like a coon dog that's got the raccoon is treed. They know there's up that tree. And, the raccoon can't go anywhere, And what we do is we call off the dogs and say, okay, we know what's what. Let's go back home now. They say the game is up, the jig is up. The ego's been exposed, the what-if game has been exposed. And we'll slip back into it again. Because of out of habit, out of familiarity. But it's been exposed. And what happens is we don't get quite as panicky. Because something in us says, well, wait a minute. We start to panic and think, I've got to search for something. I've got to find something. Where is that what-if that's a real, that's not a what-if? Where is that? And I got to, you know, start feeling that feeling, that terrible feeling. That, oh, I'm overwhelmed by the spiritual path, and how can I ever find it? And I'm lost, and all this stuff. Start feeling this. You just say, whoa, wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute. I'm sure there is a simple, immediate perspective shift on this that will take all the wind out of the sails of it. You know there is. So you just kind of be still and quiet, and you don't get panicky or frantic. You just stay calm. And you say, well, I'm a little confused now, but I know clarity is a simple, easy, simple fact. It's all a trick. Very simple little trick. And then you save yourself enormous time and suffering and effort, just like that. You get off the tracks a little bit, and then you put the brakes on and say, oh, I don't need to go down this track. If we don't have this clarity, what happens? We start going down the wrong track, and then we think that we need to accelerate to go faster so we can get through this part of the track faster and accelerate our search. So that's the problem that a lot of people on the spiritual path have. They get off the track and they think they need to work harder and accelerate faster, and they burn themselves out trying to untangle themselves from everything. They say, I know there's a way to get unentangled, and they think, well, I just have to work at it, disentangling from all these millions of entanglements, and then they burn themselves out. That's a very classic thing that happens. But the fact is, we don't have to disentangle ourselves from anything. There is no entanglement. What if is not an entanglement? If we say, what if there were billions of entanglements? Are there billions of entanglements? Or is that a what if statement? It's a what if statement. And if we see, if we catch it right at the beginning, then we don't need to go any further than that, and we don't need to concern ourselves with the billions of what ifs. If we say, what if there were billions of entanglements of in what if situations, again, that is a single what if statement. And if we just say, okay, I'm going to look at it just right there. Now, why don't we look at it right there? Because it then the alternative of choosing unconditional love is immediately an option that comes up immediately. We say, well, wait a minute. If all this is just one what-if statement, what do I need to do to get free of just this one what-if statement? And then experience unconditional love. That's all I need to do. Remember what I am. And then, boom, you see, we're free. We've done it. So, we're afraid to see the one what if statement. See it as just one statement. Instead, we keep trying to, you know, resolve all the millions of what ifs. When we hear what if there were millions of what ifs, we think, okay, well, I need to battle all these millions of what ifs one by one. Instead of saying, wait a minute, what if there were millions of what ifs is one what if statement. Not millions. Because as soon as we see that, we're right there with a choice. Because there's nothing else to do, right? If there's only one what-if statement, which is really what if we could change what we are, then what do we do with our time, you know? Immediately, we say, well, there's only one statement, actually, being made here. So do I keep it or do I set it down? That's the only. Immediately, we see that's about it. That's all we can do with it. Either we keep it or we set it down. And if we set it down, automatically that means we're picking up unconditional love. And so we've come to the end of the path, you know, just like right, boom, like that. That's why we don't see it as one statement, which is why we remain confused and suffering. But as we see this, as we hear this, as we consider it, we start saying, aha, wow, I'm not in nearly as bad a shape as I thought I was. I don't have to spend, I'm not going to be spending, much more time on this. I'm pretty darn close here. This is very doable. This is pretty easy. This is very easy. It's not difficult. Wow. See? And the wind is being taken out of the sails of the ego, just like that. All right. So, yeah, it's not that late. It's not that late. Still a beautiful evening. You see what effort does. It really brings us to the right place. Those who make the effort in satsang reap the benefits of it. And the benefits are to be freed from an illusionary complexity. Complexity that actually really isn't there at all. A what-if statement is a what-if statement. There are not millions of different kinds of what-if statements. A what-if is a what-if. Hypothetical is hypothetical. The hypothetical obscures this fact by saying that there's some hypothetical that's not a hypothetical, or that's a different hypothetical. But that statement itself is a hypothetical. Hypothetically, there's a hypothetical that is not a hypothetical, is a hypothetical statement. Hasn't gone anywhere. Hasn't changed. It's not just exactly what it is. It's a hypothetical statement. There aren't any different hypothetical statements. There's only one. Hypothetical statement is a hypothetical statement, and it's not real, and therefore it has no meaning. There's no depth to delusion at all. It's just one hypothetical. It's just a hypothetical. That's all it is. And again, saying what if it wasn't a hypothetical, that too is just nothing more than a hypothetical. So one is not lost. Seeing it from this perspective cannot be pulled away. I remember we used to go to this, went to this funhouse carnival on the Ocean Beach area, I think, of San Francisco. And they had all these rides, you know, wonderful stuff. Wood slides, long wooden slides on gunny sacks. And they had this vast platter in a room with cushions all around this platter. On the floor and on the side of the walls. And what you do is you get on this platter, and the platter would start to spin. You'd sit on this wood platter, I think, and it would start spinning and spin faster and faster and faster, around, round, 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 round. And eventually the centripetal force would cause people to just go flying off the platter, and they go sliding into the room and against the cushions. And it was great fun. And for me, what happened was, I found out, you see, I wanted to stay on this platter. I found out if you get close to the center, you don't experience it as bad. If you're out towards the edge of the platter, you know, very powerful, you're gone in a hurry. So what happened was, I got close to the center, and then I braced myself, and I was able to cling to it, you know, and they couldn't get me off the platter. And the operator got really frustrated. He kept spinning and spinning and spinning, trying to get me off the platter, and he couldn't get me off. And I was the only one that was able to stay on the platter. And I always remember that. It's like, this represents what I am here. is getting near the center and not being thrown away from it, far away from it. And here we are right now realizing that a hypothetical is simply that. It is a hypothetical. And saying that there's billions of hypotheticals, that's just one hypothetical. That's still just a hypothetical. And hypotheticals don't have any distancing power from what they are. There's zero distancing power in hypotheticals. None. There's no real distance. There's no real dimension. There's no real meaning. Zero. You see, that's so we're staying very close to truth. At the very center is unconditional love and experiencing that. The closer we get to the center, the less centripetal force there is that is throwing us away, you know, spinning us out into the delusion of distance. That somehow there's some depth to hypotheticals. Again, if we say hypothetically, there's a vast, vast depth to hypotheticals. That there's no real depth to that statement at all. But it's a hypothetical, which means there's no depth to it. It's not true. It's just a what if. What if there were infinite dimensions of what if? Well, that again, is that statement itself has no dimension to it whatsoever. It's still a what if. See? Very simple stuff. Everybody can understand this. I'm sure that everyone listening has at some point understood this, and especially when you're younger, probably is a piece of cake. Gradually, we get into the habit of simply assuming there's some distancing, there's some dimension to it. Not realizing it's meaningless, not realizing it's flat. And we get into these bad habits, and before you know it, we have a hard time with this. We may think, you know what? It used to be easy for me. I don't understand why it's so difficult now. Yeah, because everyone in this world is overlooking this. Thinking, believing, having faith, there's some dimension, some distance to hypotheticals. The hypotheticals have some depth to them. There's some kind of depth. Hypothetical can establish a depth. It cannot. We grow accustomed to everybody believing and having faith in this. And before you know it, this familiarity has gripped us. And now we have to go through the satsang, you know, and get free of that. That's how it is here. Yeah, there's really almost no way around that except those who never lose sight of truth. And they always remain as they are here, perfect teachers. But the rest of us, if we lose sight of truth even for a moment, that moment will, the ego will seize upon that moment and turn it into a hypothetical of depth and of vastness and distancing and complexity and entanglements. Immediately that hypothetical will be given to us, and suddenly we feel suddenly we've entered into a vast scenario, when the truth is we have done no such thing. We've only entertained one hypothetical, just entertained a hypothetical. The ego will immediately say, well, what if you were entertaining infinite hypotheticals, you know? And if you don't see it from the very beginning like that, then you'll think you are entertaining infinite hypotheticals, thinking there's some difference, and immediately lost. So the ego will, you know, plays hardball. As soon as we are willing to entertain a hypothetical, the ego will jump us, bushwhack us with, what if you were lost in infinite hypotheticals? And boom, and immediately we think we're in some other world, some other place, some other, you know, we fall asleep, into a deep sleep. Well, at least we believe and think we've fallen into a deep sleep, but we're not really in a deep sleep. We're actually in the lightest sleep imaginable, because we're entertaining just one hypothetical, really. We're just entertaining a hypothetical. We're entertaining hypotheticalness. And there's no sleep in that. Seeing that, there is no real depth at all. Zero. So we're not really deep asleep. We think we are. We believe we are. We have faith that we are. We speak as if we are. But we're not. Never have been. Never will be. We're only one simple step of recognition away from choosing to experience unconditional love. That's for all of us. That's always the fact. Will always be the fact. So as you see insane, the dance of existence, the dance of hypotheticals, the dance of what-ifs, doing this insane dance here, realize that we're all one simple recognition away from choosing to experience unconditional love, and unconditional love is here for everyone unconditionally. Everyone is already pre-qualified. And the depth to the madness will flatten out. And if we're fortunate enough to prepare in this way, someday we'll come across a perfect teacher. And then we'll get the boost of reassurance will be so profound that we'll realize, yeah, this is what we've been conceptualizing is true. I mean, it's pointing to the truth. It's aiming us and turning us right in the direction of truth. And then we only need to, you know, embrace truth, and that's it. We realize the depth of hypotheticals is only a mirage. It was a perceptual illusion of depth because we wanted to believe that we could change what we are, but that's why. But it was just a mirage of depth. There's no real depth there at all. There never was. And so this is all pretty simple stuff. It's not complex. Truth is not complex at all. If we see that it's just a flat illusion of depth. You know, like those books that they have now with all those wavy lines, kind of where if you stare at it for long enough, you suddenly get the illusion of depth and you see all this. I used to look at those books. I was amazing. I was very good at going back and forth. It's flat, and then suddenly the depth is there. Now it's flat. And practicing like that, going back and forth. And what you think is just a flat page, suddenly you see like there's an ocean there, and there's ships, and you see all this depth. From those books, very interesting. But again, it's actually flat. But perceptually, we're thinking, we're believing, we're seeing, oh, there's all this depth there. It's not really there at all. It's just a mirage, a trick of perception. Perception is really the tool that the mirage gives to us to view the mirage. It's like mirage hands us a pair of glasses and say, look through these glasses. We look through the glasses and, oh, wow, there's all this depth there. Suddenly we think, wow, I was missing all this before. But it's a misperception. We take the glasses away and poof, you know, we'd see, oh, it's just a mirage, it's a misperception. Well, it's too nice here to stop the satsang. It's really, I don't know, this evening could just go on. I guess it'll go on all night like this. See, inland, the air gets hot over the ocean. The air gets very cool. And in between, when the inland and the ocean are balanced and neither one is pushing one way or the other, then in between those two, air is very still and almost feels perfect. And that's how it feels here. But even better than that is the teaching, is the satsang of focusing in on the very simple way to freedom. And reminding ourselves that all we do to forget this is to say, what if I forget this, then what? We're not actually forgetting it. What we're doing is saying, what if we forgot it? And all we really need to do is say, well, wait a minute, I don't want to forget it. But what if I forget it? It's not important, because I'm remembering that forgetfulness is only in the what if. I'm not actually forgetting what I am. I'm only playing the game of what if I forgot it. And right then, you know, boom, suddenly we're back. Very fortunate are the ones who have realized this, and there are some in this world, no doubt about it. Very, very fortunate. And we certainly will share that good fortune at some point too. Not far away from it at all. You know, the addiction to believing that there's some kind of distancing is lessening. And we don't need to be in any hurry to get anywhere, right? Because there's no real distancing at all. That's why in Satsang we're relaxed. We're not frantic. Because we're not trying to untangle anything. We're trying to see that the entanglement itself is a hypothetical what if. What if there were entanglements? What if there were infinite entanglements? That's one statement. Not an entanglement. One statement is not an entanglement, is it? What is it entangling with? Is it entangling with unconditional love? No. Unconditional love is not entangled with anything. So what is this statement entangling with? It's not entangled with anything. So immediately right there we realize we're free. We're not entangled. So it's never too late to choose unconditional love. Because it's always right now. There's no entanglement. There's no real entanglement. The statement of what if there were infinite entanglements is not itself an entanglement. And even better than that, we can sit it, we can say this. We can listen to this. We can see it. And this seeing is a seeing of reason, right? It's not a perceptual seeing we're talking about. We're actually seeing, but it's not a perceptual seeing. We're saying a statement about infinite entanglements, that one statement, what is it entangled with? It's one statement, how can it be entangled with anything? See, that's seeing with reason. Reason is a way of seeing. It's a way of seeing that clarifies. And it's never too late. There's no real time. What if there were time? Is that time? No. Is one statement right now, what if there was time? That statement itself is not time. So that statement, what is that statement? What? How much time is there with that statement? There's none. It's just this moment. So really there's only this moment, this moment, this moment. There's no time, there's no space. There's only this moment. And we can easily say, yeah, we can say these things. It's is never too late to choose to experience unconditional love. It's never too late to see the statement of what if there was infinite time. That statement is, there's no time to it at all. It's not placed in time, so we can examine it right now. Well, the statement, what if there was infinite space, is not itself placed in space. We can examine that right now. Perfectly clear, we can see it, all of it. It's undisguised, it's not hidden. The statement, what if there was infinite time, is not hidden in time at all. The statement, what if there was infinite space, is not hidden at all to us. It's perfectly right here, this moment. We see all of it. It's not obscured in the slightest bit. Statement, what if there was infinite obscuration? That statement is not obscured at all. You see, and we can train ourselves. We can let go of the bad habits we've had of jumping knee-jerk reaction, thinking, oh my gosh, what if there was infinite obscuration and confusion? What would I do? Instead, we start panicking. Now, wait a minute. The statement, what if there was infinite confusion? That statement is right here now. It's not in the context of infinite confusion. It's in the context of right now. We're saying what if right now. What if it were so is a complete statement right now. So we can see it perfectly right now. And maybe one morning we'll be as fortunate as Eckhart Tolle and we'll wake up and all of this ego, all this what-if complex disappeared. And then we'll talk about, you know, the eternal now. But we'll do it in our own way. In the way that feels, you know, our style. Feel most comfortable. A lot of different styles. There's no one style that everyone will appeal to everyone. The fortunate ones somehow have seen that the statement, you know, what if there was infinite time? That statement is a statement right now. And we can see the totality of that statement right now. We don't have to go off in time at all to see the totality of that statement. The totality of that statement is right now. And they see that to such an extent that something, some shift in perception occurs where they no longer ever are tempted to see, to be lost in those type of what-ifs. They never deviate from the right now, from now. And we know there's something profound there, and we try to interpret it and understand it, but we don't quite really get it. We ourselves have to go through the satsang and approach it in some way. This is one approach here. It's sort of the approachless approach. We need to realize that there is no approach because that the totality of the statement, like say, what if there was infinite approaches? Well, that's a what-if statement right now. See the totality of that statement right now. What if we could be lost in space? Well, that statement itself is not lost in space, is it? It's not set in the context of space at all. It's set in the context of right now. So those who are awake, so to speak, are never lose sight of that. They have had this crystallized, and they're abiding in that, and more than that, they are abiding in unconditional love. Because this realization morphs then into the experience of unconditional love. It's automatic. Because that's all there really is. Because the right now is unchanging. It doesn't become time. Everything is seen right now. The totality. So there is this profound realization, and we're approaching it right now. When are we approaching it? Right now. The approach is a right now situation too. So it goes. We don't have to struggle with it too much here. Certainly, there will be a time when this crystallizes, where this realization comes for us. Why? Because we made the effort to break bad habits. Really, we have cultivated bad habits. The worst habit of all is we've cultivated the habit of what if we don't need to break bad habits. And the bad habit is believing that a statement can be set in the context of what it's referring to, which is insanity. The statement of what if there was infinite time is not set in infinite time. It's a what if right now, you see. But as soon as we think, oh, this statement itself is within the infinite time, then we're insane. We've lost truth. Lost the now. Vanished, you know. We're lost. Really terrible. And then to say that we don't need to break this habit of being lost, of accepting this insanity, which is habitual with us, that just compounds things, compounds problems for us. We do need to break the habit. We cannot just say, well, this is all untrue and I don't need to do anything about it. That's just a conceptual mantra. But the fact is that we are in this position of insanity because we've cultivated the habit of it. And that habit has to be broken. And so the breaking of that habit is what we call satsang. That's just one term for it. It's a useful term. And so we're breaking the chains of habit. See, not that there's any truth to distancing, but our habit is to overlook this fact that there's no truth to it. And so we have to break that habit of overlooking right now, that all what ifs originate right now and don't extend at all. The statement itself doesn't go anywhere. It's still right here, right now. And we have to break the habit of overlooking that fact. Like if we say, what if there was infinite space? Well, again, that statement is right here, right now with us. It's not out there in space, in infinite space. It's saying, what if there was infinite space? It's not actually out there in infinite space at all. It's right here, right now. And we've overlooked that. We think, oh, okay, well, what if it was out in infinite space? Well, where would it be in infinite space? That's a habit. We have this vast habit of doing it. And we know it's wrong, but that habit just keeps repeating and repeating like a song in your mind. You can't get it out. It's horrible. Over and over and over we hear this song. And oh boy, how do we get rid of that song? Well, we get rid of it by satsang. Get rid of the song by satsang. Maybe satsang should mean the great song. And clarification is the great song. And it's never too late to hear the great song. All right. Very, very great. This has really been something. This has the flavor. This really has the flavor. Have the scent. I was able to tune out the citronella and the deer away scent, which is a rotten egg scent. Never even smelled it at all because I was not paying any attention to what I was smelling. And I guess this airplane is simply the end of the satsang. Beautiful. Let's take a listen to it. out this evening is so still. It's incredible. Beautiful evening. California dreaming, but we were so into satsang, wasn't even aware, it didn't matter, because satsang is the great song, is transcends time and place, because suddenly we remember, wow, wait a minute, I'm not lost in time and space at all. And that's even better than being in a nice place in time and space. All right, very great, that's it.